Hello everyone, I am Dr. Sabin Mehta. I am an MD Pathology. A very warm welcome to Pathology Bites. So I have been receiving a lot of queries from all those students who have opted for MD Pathology. So I thought it would be best to address all those queries on this very platform. So before starting, I hope all the students who are listening to this video message are those people who have a keen interest in pursuing pathology as their career option, as they have opted for it. So firstly, I want to start about what are the future aspects of pathology. So let me tell you, pathology is all about reading, and yes, honestly, lots of reading. You have to be a keen learner and you have to have interest in reading and give a lot of time to know all the aspects of pathology. And there is not much exposure to this very beautiful branch of pathology in our undergraduate days, though some people might think that yes, we have been exposed to Robbins or Hirschman textbook of pathology, but trust me, pathology is much beyond than your imagination and thinking. It is not only a branch or a subject of just beautiful colors. There is much more to it. There are so many subspecialties, many domains and many parts to it. Let me tell you one by one. So pathology generally consists of basic three components. One is cytopathology, another one is histopathology, and the third pillar is hematology. Right, so I'll be talking about them one by one. So firstly, if we talk about cytopathology mainly deals with fluid biopsies and the liquid biopsy. So I want to tell all the budding pathologists that they should be very well versed and they should have an hands-on training on the various techniques involved in this particular part of pathology, that they should be well versed with the technique of FNAC, that is fine needle aspiration cytology, various staining techniques like pap staining. So they should be well versed with all these techniques when they get their particular posting. We have a particular time frame when we are posted in certain these branches. So all the budding pathologists should be very well versed when they are posted in the cytology department, because honestly, this is actually the bread and butter of a pathologist. It is going to be make a very big part and a very big influence in your further clinical practice, right? Because it's always says that there is a clinico-pathological correlation. Always when you receive a case, a clinician refers a case to you or a surgeon refers to case to you, that there are for example, there is a patient who comes referred by a clinician, that there are multiple swellings in the cervical region. So a pathologist, what the pathologist is supposed to do, a pathologist does the FNAC under all the aseptic precautions and after the staining is done, and when you look for the your cytological slides, you actually make an impression whether it's like an inflammatory lymphadenitis or a glandulomatous one, or there are mets. So you actually correlate all these cytological findings with the clinical findings, right? That's why it is always said that you always have to have a clinico-pathological correlation. Honestly, clinician is incomplete, and that way pathologist is also an incomplete branch. Okay, they both go hand in hand, right? So it is generally said, a surgeon generally says that one should never open the mouth until and unless you do a biopsy. So basically, if you say, the crux of the story is that pathology actually makes the diagnostic outcome to an end, right? So it basically puts an end to all the queries and all the questions which a surgeon or a clinician may have in their mind. So that's what I feel, that it is the basis of every disease or the outcome, right? So after moving to the after learning about the cytology, another component of this beautiful branch is histology. And honestly, this thing I've seen in a lot of first year residents. In fact, I was also a part of that. When we enter into the histology section of our clinical lab, we were always very keen, we were always interested in knowing the slides first. So this is one basic mistake which every first year PG resident is about to make. that you know, you always try to jump up to the conclusions. You always try to jump up to the conclusions that what pathological disease, what pathology you are able to find. That is the first basic mistake we always make. You know, it is very important to first learn the histology of an organ. Say for example, you know that you got a case, you got a slide of gallbladder. So rather moving to scanning those slides, first we should learn about how a basic gallbladder will look on a tissue section. What is the basic histology, all the linings, the epithelium, the muscularis and everything, so that it makes a better impression of that particular organ in your mind. So you know, once you know the basic histology, it will be very easy for you to know what alterations or what abnormalities are there in the basic thing. Matlab koi bhi cheez alag hogi, so you will be like, you will be fast enough to catch that, right? That's what I meant. So this was one basic thing which is usually ignored by the first year residents. And remember, never lose heart. You know, slides and their learning is never easy, and it should not affect you from the day one. Stepwise learning, you have to be very patient, calm and composed. Slowly, slowly, step by step, you will obviously grasp it and learn what are the basics of, you know, diagnosing, what are the basics of scanning a slide. So you have to be very patient, and honestly the first step to that is always grossing. Remember that. Never let grossing, you know, never let take it easy that it is okay. No, it is always said that grossing, at the time of grossing, half of the diagnosis is already made by the pathologist. So you know, that is what grossing is very important. That is why grossing is very important. It makes a very important part of your diagnosis, because you know, there are certain protocols by which every organ has to be grossed, and especially if you get a suspected case of any carcinoma. So there are certain protocols that you have to follow while grossing that particular specimen. So like if you being a pathologist, you are grossing a particular specimen, so you know which sections you have taken at that time, what did you see, and then which section you have to focus upon while staining the slide, while paraffin sectioning, embedding, and while scanning the slide. You very well know what you were thinking at that point of time, what hemorrhage, necrosis or any abnormal growth which your naked eye was seeing at that point of time, that you will be able to make it when you see that particular section under your microscope. So how beautiful it is. You are actually correlating what your eye was seeing and then what the tissue is talking to you, right? So this is what I want to tell you, that grossing forms the mainstay of any histopathological diagnosis. So always grossing is the first step to start. Never think that we have entered in the first year in the histology section, we have been posted there. So never jump on the scanning the slides. Always start from the basics, right? And remember, every tissue has a story to tell. So you have to be very patient in listening to that story, in watching to that story. And you know, you have to learn step by step. And every hospital has their own workload, but it is usually seen that uterus, cervix, appendix, gallbladder, these are mainly, they form the main workload, main samples of any clinical lab, right? So you have to be well versed at least about these tissues. And the very third pillar of the beautiful branch of pathology is hematology. In hematology, you will get routine blood testings, the reporting, the Leishman staining, and obviously the bone marrow aspiration, and it also includes various leukemias, blood malignancies and as well. Honestly, hematology is you know, operation like operator dependent and mostly machine dependent, but again they are in symbiosis with each other so as to get a, you know, a final clinical report, right? So which can help the clinician to further decide the diagnosis and the prognosis, right, and the treatment. So again, I told you, clinical pathological correlation always stay the, always remains the mainstay, right? So talking about recent advances, like radiology, like has been superseded, like kind of superseded by nuclear medicine, that ways pathology has also some recent advances which are coming, and obviously have come and are coming these days. So such fields are like molecular biology or the genetics or the immunohistochemistry. I'm sure you all must have solved a lot of MCQs regarding all those cytogenetic analysis and the leukemia classifications and all to enter into this beautiful first year of residency in pathology. So yes, these are the recent advances in the beautiful branch of pathology. So you know, it is always said that, you know, it is a mindset of the people that in pathology, you are not going to see a patient, right? Agreed. You are not going to see a patient, but you always have to read the patient's case history from a clinician mindset. Can you understand it? So for that, you need to have like lot of case reading and analysis and lot of discussions with your clinician, maybe over a telephonic call or over a cup of tea, so that it can make you awake and aware of the discussions, because the discussions with your clinicians are of paramount importance, because they help you see the larger picture behind it. If you get a sample or a tissue or a fluid, so that you can know what is beyond what you are seeing in a slide, right? So obviously discussions with your clinicians always helps you. And yes, I've told you earlier, grossing has to be done on your own, because I told you, because half of the diagnosis is made at the time of grossing itself. So that is also very important. So, you know, one should always have your slide box in your hand. It should be available. If any interesting case you see while your postings in hematology, histopathology or cytology sections, your slide box should be prepared. Any special case you see, any leukemias or the metastasis or the carcinomas, Hodgkin's lymphoma or any other case, there should be a slide box. At the end of the 3 years, you will have your own slide collection. Okay, and you know, I always, when I entered in my first year residency, I had the best microscope, because it was easy for me to fix my eyes on that, so that I can have the comfort of looking the slides provided by my department or by my own or my thesis slides as well. So I prefer that one should have their own microscope as well. So I told you earlier as well that the main emphasis should be learning the basic histology first. That is the most important thing to learn. Pathology can be learned if you know the basic histology of the tissue, right? Because it will become very easy for you to catch what is the abnormal in the tissue if you know what is actually normal for the tissue. Do you understand that? Exactly. So yes, about all of these, I know you all must be wanting me to tell you about what all books you have to study. So obviously the Bible of pathology, Robbins, that you know, it is the base of the pathology. And yes, I have been telling you again and again that the basic histology has to be understood. For that, so you have for that you can refer to DeFeo's Atlas of Histology. There is a very beautiful book, Vita's Histopathology. You have the best pictorial representation of all the tissue. And for, you know, if you want to have diagnostic pathological images, you can opt for the Curran's Atlas of Histopathology. It has a lot of images of all the pathological conditions with a little description. So if you are in a histopathological section of your lab, so you should always keep these atlases handy with you, so that it will be easier for you to understand the basic tissue and learn according to that. Other, if you are in the cytology section, then oral book is usually preferred. And sometimes there are certain diagnoses, generally for thyroid, I used to prefer you know, Gray's book of cytology for the thyroid malignancies and the thyroid swellings. So personally, I preferred both oral, and for thyroid I used to prefer Gray's. And for hematology, there's a very beautiful book called as Vintrobes. So you can refer for that. And for clinical practices of hematology, De Crucci, even Dacey, and is a very good book. De Crucci I personally like, because there are a lot of flow charts in it, like how to approach a case of macrocytic anemias or microcytic anemia. So basically you will get a practical knowledge about how to approach to a case. So that way, De Crucci is a very beautiful book according to me. And to learn about various fluids that you get in the cytology for the TLC, DLC. So for the fluids, you can refer to Henry and Toad. And yes, if you are like I have planned in entering into this world of pathology, you have to be updated all the time. So WHO keeps on giving its various fascicles for all the tumors, hematolymphoid tumors, breast tumors, bone and soft tissue tumors. So all those WHO fascicles should be with you whenever you want to read about a tumor, its latest classification. So WHO should be with you. And yes, if you are learning the basic histology and pathology from the atlas, so one reference book should always be there to refer to some, if you find some interesting case and you want to learn more about it. So one reference book should be there. It can be either Rozai and Ackerman or the Sternberg. Both are the same. It depends on you. Personally, I used to prefer Rozai and Ackerman. It has a lot of beautiful images and like very good description as well. And yes, two very important books I wanted to tell you, that Bethesda system, when you will be reporting pap smears. So the pap smear reporting is generally done on the basis of the Bethesda system, and the thyroid is also done. So Bethesda system for thyroid and cervical should be handy when you are reporting the pap smears cases and the thyroid FNAC cases. And yes, there is an exam for at the end of the 3 years, you'll be having a separate exam for the recent advances in histopathology and hematology. So that also should be with you. And you know, when you will be reporting in certain institutes, when you will be reporting, there are certain CAP protocols used. So one, you should always have a knowledge of these CAP protocols, basically for the tumors. So those are also very important, right? So this was all about the books, and I know I have told you a lot of books I've told you, but remember, one book at a time. As you proceed further, you move further, you can keep on adding the books, and obviously PDF soft copies are always available. So don't panic, one book at a time. As you move on to your postings, like for 3 months or 6 months, if you're posted in histopathology, just focus on that. Focus on the histopathological section, like all those cases, all those slides, all those grossing techniques, just focus on that. Once you move to the cytopathological section, then you focus on the how the pathologists, how your seniors are doing it, the technique of FNAC. And one thing I want to tell you, you know, generally what we feel that staining, it is a part of the technicians. There's no need to understand. But this is not right. You should understand each and everything. The basics are always important, right? So like basics, start from the staining till the scanning of the slides. You should be well versed with each and everything. And once you're posted in hematology, then you should, you know, you should understand what techniques are using, what is hematoanalyzer are using, what are the flags, what is the, you know, 3-part, 6-part. You should be like aware of everything, right? So as we all know that pathology is not an end branch. There are subspecialties to it as well. So one, there is DM hematopathology or DM genetics, and there is DM histopathology, which is offered by PGI and many other central institutes of the country as well. So lastly, if you look for the career options, there are two options, either the government institutions or the private opportunities. Honestly, I thought after completing my MD, I'll do a SRship in one of the government hospitals or maybe teaching in medical colleges. So there are options. And the other part to it is the private opportunities. You know, if somebody has the urge to pursue this branch further and learning more about it, then they can enter into the fellowships. One such fellowship is like oncology fellowship. You can do it in Tata Memorial Hospital or the Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Institute. One is in Mumbai and one is in Delhi. And you can also enter into the corporate world. Honestly, I've been there, I've done that. That takes a lot of effort, hard work, sweat. But trust me, at the end of the day, you feel that your day was worthwhile. So yes, and lastly, you can have your own diagnostic center, but you, as know, all of you as know that it is always a clinician dependent, that clinicians have to refer cases to you. But it is worth a try, right? Worth the try and worth the pain. So these are the career options you can think of later on. So my advice to all you people who are entering into the first year of residency is that these are your beautiful 3 years, right? So try to make most of it. Learn things as like they are coming. Don't try to haste. Don't try to run. Don't worry. Things will come to you. Slowly, slowly, just be calm, patient and composed. And yes, get ready to read a lot, a lot, a lot. But trust me, that is going to help you in your future for sure. So this is me, Dr. Shagun Mehta. All the best to all of you who are entering into this beautiful field of pathology. Stay safe, stay happy. Thank you.